Go ahead.
Survivor of the Shoah interview, October
11,
1994. Just, every day.
Survivor Renee Firestone, interviewer Cy Frumkin. In the city of Beverly Hills, the interview will be conducted in English.
Just read it again really fast because they spoke really fast.
Survivor of the Shoah interview, October 11, 1994. Survivor Renee Firestone, interviewer Cy Frumkin, city of Beverly Hills. The interview will be in English.
Renee, where do you come from in Europe?
I was born and raised in the eastern part of Czechoslovakia. As a matter of fact, in a region which in the 20th century belonged to five different countries.
Really?
At my birth, it was Czechoslovakia, and of course in 1938 it became Hungary. It was a lovely town. And I never went back. It was Ushhorod when it was Czechoslovakia, and then it became Ungvar when it was Hungary. And now it's Uzhgorod. It belongs to the Ukraine.
And what was your life like before the war?
I come from a very loving, middle-class Jewish family. My parents were not religious, but I remember my only grandfather I knew was Grandfather Rosenfeld, died at the age of 96 in an accident. And he used to go to the temple every morning and every evening. And I remember when I went to his house that he had a rack with these fancy pipes, long ones, short ones. As a child, I was always fascinated by that. And I have fantastic memories about my grandfather. He was a real character. He always, at summertime, wore these starched white suits like he just came out of a box. And when he saw the grandchildren, he reached in his pocket and started to crackle the paper that was in there, and we knew that there is candy, and used to ask him for the candy. My father was a businessman, and he had a textile business and a tailor shop. He was a very fine craftsman. My mother, when she was young, before she got married, she was already a businesswoman. She and two other sisters went to Vienna, and they had a millinery shop. And then when my mother got married, then she became a housewife. I have a brother who is 4 years older than myself, and I had a sister who was 5 years younger than myself. My brother's name is Frank, my sister's name was Clara, and my daughter Clara is named after her.
You were about 16, I think, when the war began in Europe.
I was 14 when Czechoslovakia was split up and we became Hungary. I was 14 years old.
How did that affect the Jews in your town? Were there a lot of Jews in your town?
Yes. It was a small town of about 32,000 population, and maybe a third was Jewish.
You said you were not religious, but you were somehow involved in some Jewish affairs. I understand you were a member of the Maccabi.
Well, after the Hungarians took over. Before that, I belonged to an organization called Sokol, which was also an athletic Czech organization. And of course, when that disappeared after Hitler donated, actually, our region to Hungary, then I joined a Jewish athletic organization called the Maccabi.
So you were already involved, you knew that you were Jewish?
Oh, absolutely, but we kept hardly anything. There was no kosher home in my house.
So you went to a general public school?
Yes, yes.
And even under the Hungarians, there was no discrimination? There were no anti-Jewish laws?
Well, of course. Of course, they began pretty early, and you know, we were sort of slowly, systematically reduced to second-class citizens. But for a while, we were still free. We were still in our homes. The family was together. And then they started to take the men into forced labor camps. And so my father was taken for a while. He was later released and came back home. And my brother was taken to forced labor camp as soon as he graduated gymnasium. And after that, he escaped later from the camp and
this
became a partisan.
This was in the early 1940s, right?
Yes. Let me tell you that my brother was actually taken from his classroom, from his graduating classroom, with a few other Jewish boys. They were taken out of the school and they disappeared. I remember that my parents were devastated. The government didn't want to tell us where they were. And my mother hired an attorney, and the attorney told my mother that the two of them will do everything possible to find out what happened to these boys. They found out that they were taken to another city called Munkacs, or Mukachevo, and they were taken in one of these to one of these castles that the Hungarians used as a torture place. And they beat up and tortured these boys, accusing them of dispersing communist propaganda. Now, my brother had never any political affiliation with anything, so we knew that it's just a, you know.
And he managed to escape?
He was finally, my parents paid and released all the boys.
All of them.
And then they came back and they graduated gymnasium.
Were there any other specific anti-Jewish laws? Did the Jews have to wear a yellow star?
Well, later, yes. Later we had to wear yellow stars and we had a curfew. My father's business was taken away from him. I would like to tell you a little incident about my father's business because at one point there was a non-Jewish family, a shoemaker who had about 9 children, came to my father and asked him to take his 13-year-old boy as an apprentice in his business. And my father took pity on him and of course took him in. Not only took him in as an apprentice, but he brought him into our house. And he grew up with us as a brother. And at the end, when we were taken to the brick factory, to the ghetto, my father wrote a letter to him to send us some supplies. And the answer was that he's not going to risk his life for us. Now, this is a young man who took over my father's business. When they said that a Jew can no longer own a business, then my father said, well, this is a Gentile son of mine. I can trust him. And he gave him the business and the money. He owned everything we owned at that point, and he wouldn't help us. So these are some of the stories about our neighbors and friends and how they supported us when we were in trouble.
And what happened after that? You were deported to Germany?
Well, yeah.
To
we,
Poland? Let me just ask you this. All this time, mass extermination was going on, mass murders of Jews in Poland and elsewhere in Eastern Europe. Were you aware of that?
Yes.
Did you know?
Let me tell you that in 1940, as early as in 1940, those Jews in my hometown and in our region who couldn't prove that their ancestors were there in 17, I don't remember exactly the date, those were deported. They were just put over the Polish border. And some of them came back and they were telling us about the murders and what's going on in Poland. So we knew that in Poland they are shooting and burying Jews in mass graves. But we had absolutely no knowledge about the Wannsee Conference or about extermination camps being built.
I see. And when did the deportations begin?
Deportations began in 1944, actually in April.
Was it done primarily by the Hungarian police, or did the Germans take part?
We were taken to the border of Poland by the Hungarians, and there the Germans took over and escorted us into Auschwitz.
By train?
By train, yes.
So tell me how you arrived in Auschwitz and how that happened. You were still, the entire family was together?
Let me tell you that we were herded into cattle cars in my hometown yet. My brother was no longer with us. He was in Hungarian forced labor camp. But my parents and my sister and I were in a cattle car where there were about 120
people. What about your grandfather, whom you mentioned earlier?
By the way, my grandfather died, I told you, at the age of 96 earlier, so he was spared, fortunately, of all this. So the ride to the journey to Auschwitz was horrifying. The cattle car was packed. There was hardly any breathing space and hardly any breathing air because there was a bucket which was supposed to be our sanitary facility, our bathroom, kept overflowing, and I don't have to tell you, within a few hours, it just kept overflowing. The cattle cars were never opened to empty it or to get a little fresh air into the car. And so the stench and the air was unbreathable. And we could actually hear people suffocating in the cattle car. Of course, there was nothing we could do about it. We had no food or water given to us. And this journey lasted 3 days. I also remember during the night the train used to stop and the Nazis used to bang on the walls of the cattle car telling us that if we are still hiding any valuables or any money, we should give it up or we'll be shot. And while they were talking to us, we could hear on the outside shooting and screaming, and we were convinced that they are searching and killing these people. I very vividly remember this old woman who was sitting on the edge of the cattle car, who ripped open her coat lining and reached in there and removed a little gold locket and started to cry, opened this locket, started to cry bitterly. And I, being young and still very optimistic and romantic, I was sort of fantasizing that maybe that's her wedding picture in the locket, or maybe her family, her grandchildren, whom she left behind. We were going somewhere, not knowing where, for how long. The rumors were that we're going to Germany to work, and that if there's healthy and strong, will work, the family will survive together. So this woman must have been in her 80s, hardly believed that she will ever return. And I thought to myself, how cruel that they won't let her keep this little memoir. And then she closed this locket and through the cracks of the cattle car handed it to the Nazis.
Yes. How old were you at the time?
I was just 19.
So this was the beginning of 1944?
That's right.
And then you arrived in Auschwitz. Did you know what that place was or where it was?
Sai, let me tell you, the cattle cars opened, and I, believing that we're going to Germany to work, was very eager to get a good job so that I can help out my parents and my little sister, so that they don't have to work so hard. I was a strong, healthy athlete, so I knew I can work, and I was going to save them. When I jumped off that cattle car and I looked around, I knew right away that we're doomed. All I could see for miles and miles were barbed wires. And, you know, so many feet, there was always a tower, a wooden tower. And when I looked up there, I saw this Nazi soldier behind the machine gun pointing it at us, watching every move we were making. On the loudspeakers, the Nazis were telling us to leave all our belongings behind. They are going to deliver it to us to the camp. And so I turned back to the cattle car and called my sister Clara, who came forth crying, rubbing her eye from the darkness into the light. And I grabbed her hand and I said to her, "You hold on to me, no matter what happens, you and I must stay together." And she started to cry and she said, "But Renee, let's wait for Mom and Dad." And I turned back to the cattle car for Mom and Dad. They were gone. And it was only then that I realized that thousands of people were pouring out of this train. The train had no end. I couldn't see the end of it. And there was tremendous chaos. Children looking for parents and mothers calling their children's names. It was impossible to find anybody. And so I kept reassuring my sister that once we get in, we will be reunited with mother and father, so don't worry about it. And of course we were caught in this human tide and just being pushed towards the camp when suddenly I found myself standing in front of this Nazi officer, a young man, very handsome, with a smiling face, a little leather whip in his hand, pointing people to the right and to the left. And it was then that I became very fearful about our future, because they promised that we're going to stay together, the families. And all of a sudden I realized that they are ripping the families apart.
So what happened then?
Then my sister and I was pointed to the right. By the way, this man who separated us was, of course, none other than the infamous Dr. Mengele.
How did you know this?
We didn't know it then. I'll tell you later how I found out who he was. I had no idea who he was. And my sister and I were marching towards the camp, not knowing what's coming. And suddenly my sister noticed that my mother is going to the other side. And so she wanted to run away from me, and I grabbed her and I said, "Don't go anywhere, you're going to get lost, you're not going to find mother, and then you're not going to find me either. So please don't go anywhere." And we were taken into an underground dressing room. And here, surrounded by Nazi soldiers and vicious dogs that were growling and barking at us, we were told we should get undressed, we're going to take a shower. So we were waiting for the soldiers to leave so we can get undressed. And of course, nobody moved. So one of the soldiers walked over to one of these women and hit her and said, "Take it off." And we realized that they are not leaving. So we started to get undressed, and again we were given orders to be very careful how we fold our belongings, remember exactly where you're leaving your clothing, because when you come out of the shower you will have to hurry up and dress and be assigned to your work. And still we were naive and stupid enough to believe that. And I told my sister to make sure that she puts her stuff next to mine so we don't get separated when we come out of the shower. Needless to say that the minute we walked into the shower room, the doors were slammed behind us. Our belongings were picked up.
Did they shave your heads?
Later. We came out naked on the other side of the shower room and stood there wet, naked, from mid-afternoon till about midnight. I remember my sister and I hugging each other for a little body wound. We were freezing. And then at midnight, they took us into this barrack where they shaved our heads, our bodies. They sprayed us with DDT, with pesticide. And then we walked through a door where two prisoners greeted us. One gave us a recycled dress, which we put on our naked bodies. And another prisoner had a bucket of yellow paint and a brush about 4 inches wide and painted a yellow streak from the top of our shaved head down through our back. This was the identification of being a Jewish prisoner. And that's how we entered the campsite.
And down your naked back or on the dress?
On the dress, through the dress. I remember the dress sticking to my body. We had no underwear, no stockings, no shoes.
No shoes either?
No shoes at that point.
And then what?
Then when we got into the camp, we were introduced to this overseer who was a capo. You know, all the overseers were called capos in the camp. And she told us to line up in columns of five.
Was she Jewish or German?
She was a Jewish Slovakian girl. Told us to line up that we will be assigned to our barracks. And when we lined up for this counting, it was cela, called celapel, being lined up to be counted. My sister started to cry, and I decided to find out where our parents are and when are we going to be reunited.
Were there any children that were younger than your sister?
My sister was the youngest.
She was 14?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I don't know whether there was in that group any other child that age.
Were there any old people, older than, say, 50 or 60?
No, of course not. Of course not. There were some mothers and daughters who passed through. But those mothers were like my mother's age, 40, 42, not older than that. And I asked this couple, when are we going to be reunited with our parents? And she pointed to one of the chimneys of the crematoria, which I didn't even see until then. And it was then that I noticed these four brick chimneys bellowing fire and soot. And she said, do you see this chimney? I said, yes. She says, there go your parents. And when you'll go through the chimneys, you'll be reunited. And I turned to my fellow prisoners and I said, what is she talking about? What does that mean? I mean, even in my darkest nightmare, I could not have imagined the things that were going on here. But let me go back for a moment because you asked me about Mengele. When did I find out about Mengele? When we were permitted to walk into the barrack from standing outside after the shower, one of my neighbors, a young girl, one of my neighbors, tapped me on the shoulders and pointed to this Nazi officer who was the same officer we met on the railroad station. And she said to me, he's asking for you. And I looked over there, and this officer was waving to me. Now, you must understand, we were totally naked. I still had my hair, my blonde hair. And I turned away, pretending that I didn't notice, didn't see. And this friend again said to me, you better go over there. I will never forget. You know, I come from a family where my father, I don't think, ever saw me in my slip, not naked. And here I'm standing. How am I going to go over there? So I crossed my arms. I didn't know where to hide myself. And when I went over there, he was with another doctor. I think his name was Dr. Klein. And they took me sort of away from the group and took me to a light which was in the ceiling, and he took his leather whip and put it under my chin and lifted my head with the whip, and I heard them talking to each other, and then he turned to me and he said, "Why are you here? Warum bist du da?"
You spoke German at the
time? A little bit, yes. What I learned in school. We were bordering with Czechoslovakia, so we had to learn German in school. And so I told him, because I'm a Jude. And he looked at me, and then he asked me about my mother and my father. Were they? What religion were they? And I kept saying, Jewish, Jude. How about your grandparents? He said, and went through all four grandparents. And I kept insisting that they all were Jewish. And he got very angry with me, and he looked at Dr. Klein, and he said to him, I remember, "Das ist unmöglich. That is impossible." And at that point, I turned back, and I saw my sister being already shaved. So I was afraid that she's going to pass through, and I'm going to lose her. So I just turned around and walked away. And one of these couples came after me and hit me on my back. I thought my back is going to break. And said to me, "Shakrev" in Polish. And then in Yiddish, she kept saying to the girls that I'm lucky that I wasn't shot. That anybody that walks away from Mengele like that is usually shot. So that was my first lucky day, I guess, to survive.
Did you finally get a chance to go to sleep? You must have been up for a couple of days.
Oh, for a long time we didn't sleep. Let me also tell you that first night when we got into the barracks and we were put up into these three-level bunks. I was on the top of one of the bunks. There were 12 of us. Six facing one direction, six facing the other direction. And we tried to rest at least. We were exhausted. We were frightened. We didn't know what next day will bring. And one of the Polish girls in the barrack started to sing Yiddish. Now, I didn't understand the language. I didn't speak Yiddish. But just from the sound of this song, I knew what she was singing. It was my first touch with my Jewishness. I just somehow knew what she was saying. And she was singing the song, "My Yiddish Mama." And I remember we all cried through the whole night.
What was
that
your next morning?
That was my first night. Next morning, we woke up to the sound of the couple banging on the bunks, running up and down, yelling, "Aufstehen, get up, heraus, everybody out, quick." Schnell was their favorite word. We ran outdoors, and again we had to line up to be counted. It was dark. It was in the middle of the night, 3 o'clock. 2-3 o'clock in the morning, and we stood there till about 10 o'clock in the morning. It was already, the sun was coming up.
Renee, you were telling us about your first morning after arriving in Auschwitz. You were taken out, you were counted, you stood there until 10 o'clock in the morning. What happened then?
Well, of course, we had no idea what comes. We thought maybe they will let us go back to the barracks and maybe we can lie down. But of course, that didn't happen. We were dispersed. First of all, after each counting, we were fed. We were counted twice a day. We lined up in the morning and then lined up around 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And if they found everybody, if everybody was accounted for, then we were fed. But the first time we lined up, I remember they brought out three blankets and laid it out in front of our lineup. And I was looking at those blankets. I didn't know what they meant, and I could see the blankets moving. So after we were dispersed, after we were permitted to move around, I asked, what were those blankets they brought out, and then they took them again away. So they told me that there were some people who came in with diabetes, and they took their insulin away from them, and they were dying right in front of us. But they had to be accounted for. So they dragged them out in the blankets and put them down in the lineup. And then in the morning, they brought these two big barrels of so-called food. They called it ersatz. It was some kind of a liquid that looked like coffee or tea, tasted more like dishwater, but it was hot, and we stood out there freezing half of the night. And then I realized that not everybody's gonna get some of that. That the first prisoner was handed a bowl, and she went to the barrel and she got some of this liquid. Then she came back and was going to share it with the five of us. Well, in the beginning, we shared, but later on, as time went on and we were starving, whoever was up front had some of the liquid. By the time the bowl reached the fourth and the fifth prisoner, there was nothing. And so from then on, it became a fight every time we did the lineup. Who's going to stand up front and who's going to be in the back? And then later we found out that without any warning, Dr. Mengele arrived after lineup and was selecting for the gas chambers. So every morning and every afternoon you had to figure out where you want to stand. You want to fight your way to the front of the lineup because you're so hungry that you may not make it to the afternoon lineup. Or you will manage to survive till the afternoon, then you really want to be in the back and hide from Mengele.
Didn't they hand out bread?
In the afternoon. In the afternoon lineup, they brought back these barrels with a similar liquid. They called it soup. And we received a slice of bread. And I remember on Sundays, they gave us a slice of, either a slice of horse meat salami, or they gave us a little bit of margarine. You had to hand out, put your hands out like this. They slapped the margarine there. Or occasionally they gave us a spoonful of a marmalade, which later we found out was made of sugar beets, something black like molasses. And I will never forget the first day when they gave us this molasses and they slapped it into our hand. My little sister Clara went like this, threw it away, and then she wiped her hand and shivered. She never touched it, never touched her soup. She couldn't drink out of that bowl that four people already handled. And so she was starving. The only thing she ate was the slice of bread that we received.
What about soap? What about keeping yourself clean, laundry?
Nothing. Probably that was the worst. And of course, later on, because of that, we were filled with lice. But water was, we had no access to water only when we went to a barrack called the latrine barrack, where we could not go individually. We were taken collectively. Usually the couple and some Nazi soldiers, again with the dogs, taking us into the latrine barracks, where we had to choose whether we want to fight our way to the water. There was water spouts in that place. Or you have to fight your way to the bathroom. And the reason was that this wasn't happening every day. Sometimes 2-3 days you didn't go to the bathroom. So when you got into this latrine barrack, you had to decide what you want. You want to rinse your dress out, or you want to wash your face, or you want to have a drink of water, or you want to go to the bathroom. And the Nazi soldiers standing around laughing at us, making fun of the women sitting on the bathrooms or standing naked, washing themselves. I only know that this humiliation remained with me forever. I am embarrassed when I see somebody being embarrassed. I feel for them. This is the kind of humiliation that destroys your humanness. It is, you just feel totally naked, totally vulnerable. You knew every time you went in there, you knew that they have the power to do anything they want to do with you.
How did some of the people handle the fact of not being able to go to the bathroom except once every 2-3 days? After all, people usually have to go more often than that.
Well, you know,
inside the barracks, wasn't there punishment for that?
If they found you, not inside the barrack, but maybe somebody did it behind the barrack.
Or you could walk out of the barracks?
If we were outside all day.
I see.
We were outside all day. We were permitted to go into the barrack only in the after the afternoon zelapel, to be settling down for the night. But we were in the dust, in the dirt, in the snow, in the rain. We were all the time outdoors.
But you didn't go to work?
No. Auschwitz-Birkenau really was not a labor camp or a work camp. It was strictly an extermination camp. And we knew that that's what we are there for, and we accepted it.
Did they take you to a delousing station at one point?
In between?
I
went through once delousing, and that was because I was selected out by Mengele to be taken to another camp next to the sea lager where I was. The B lager was emptied the week before. I like to tell you about that because the B lager at that time was occupied by midgets, non-Jewish midgets, where they brought in the whole families, the parents, the children, the grandparents. And we were so jealous that they were permitted to stay with their parents, and we were separated, not knowing where our families were. And one night, as we were walking into our barrack to settle down, we were told that no matter what we hear, we may not come out or look out. And that night, in the middle of the night, we could hear screaming and shooting, and we could understand that there is an action going on in the camp next to us. And next morning when we woke up, we found all these midgets piled up like logs in front of their barracks. It was around September, at the height of the final solution, at the height of the exterminations. And the crematorias were burning 24 hours a day, and apparently there was not room in the crematoria for these people, so they gassed them overnight, and then they were sitting there for about 3 days until they were finally slowly taken into the crematoria and disposed of. And so a week later, I was selected from my camp going into the other camp. It was then that I was separated from my sister, Clara. And when Mengele pointed me to go to the other side, I tried to run back to my sister because I knew she was weak, she was very skinny. I knew she would not take a chance. So I ran back to her, and Mengele caught me and handed me to the kapo. And the kapo beat me brutally and pushed me back to the other side. And we were separated. But we arranged to meet at the wires, through the wires every morning at a certain place so that we can wave to each other and tell each other that we are still alive and we're still okay. And on Yom Kippur in 1944, we were worried before Yom Kippur that something is going to happen because the Nazis always had something in store for us during holidays or on Shabbat. And I came to the wires and my sister didn't show. And I thought maybe she was just upset because of the holiday, and I thought maybe the following morning and she didn't show then either. And when she didn't come the third day, I knew that something happened to her. After the war, I found out that there were big selections in the sea lager and that she was selected out to be killed that day.
And what happened to you after that? You were now in a different camp, which was no longer a selection camp?
Yeah, still. It was no different. It was just getting busier because the last groups of Hungarians were brought in at that time, and the Greeks, Salonika was emptied, and they, the Salonican Jews were brought in. Some Italian Jews were brought in, and some Dutch Jews were brought in after us, and those were the last transports, and it was getting very busy in Auschwitz. So then a few months later we heard that they are going to evacuate. Let me just tell you that in September, before my sister died yet, there were Americans flying overhead. We saw the little silver dots in the glittering in the sunshine, and everybody yelled, "The Americans, the Americans." And the sirens were going, and the Germans went into the bunkers, and we stayed outdoors. And we were hoping that they are going to just bomb the whole place to pieces, including us. We didn't care. But they didn't. They flew over Auschwitz-Birkenau, and then we heard bombing. There was a about 8 kilometers from us, a factory, IG Farben, Auschwitz, and I presume that's what they were bombing.
It was an artificial rubber factory.
Yeah.
There was a docent at the Wiesenthal Center who was one of the pilots,
yeah.
And they were under express orders not to bomb Auschwitz.
I know. And they, even if they didn't bomb Auschwitz, if they would have just bombed the railroad before it reached Auschwitz, thousands and thousands of Jews and others could have been saved. You know, probably my biggest shock was really after the war, when I found out that so many non-Jews were also murdered in Auschwitz.
Did you know how the war was going at that point?
No, we didn't, but we knew that the Americans were in the war because of the planes. And I don't know how those who told us that those were American planes, how they knew. But there was an underground in Auschwitz. And so apparently...
Did you have any contact with non-Jewish prisoners?
I had contacts later with one Polish political prisoner who was a doctor in our camp in Libau.
I think it was in 1944 that one of the crematoria was blown up by the underground in Auschwitz. Were you there
that
when
was,
it happened?
Yeah, that was just before they took us away. Yes.
What happened? Were there any repercussions
just
to you?
Not to me. The underground, of course, one of the women who brought in, who smuggled in the dynamite, was hung with a few other people. As a matter of fact, you know Freddie Diamond?
Yeah.
His brother was hung, and he watched it. So... But to us it was, we just knew that there was an explosion and we knew that a crematoria was bombed.
And then they decided to evacuate you?
Yes. Then.
Did you know that this was because the Russians were coming closer?
We were hoping. We really didn't have exact knowledge of it. But we realized that something must be going on during the war, in the political war. And so they told us that they are going to liquidate the camp. And I was sent on a death march.
Were you evacuated again by train? Was it just as bad as the first train?
Let me tell you, that was the time when we were deloused again. We were taken back into the showers. The truth is that we did not know that there is a difference between the showers and the gas chambers. And every time they took us in there, we didn't know what's going to happen to us. And so we feared that we are going to be finished. It was pouring rain that day, icy water. And so they took us, and we took this shower, and then they hoarded us outside naked. And we stood there from morning uphill till about 4 o'clock in the afternoon in that icy rain. And that's when the second miracle happened. The night before, I was burning up with fever. I used to have tonsillitis very often as a child. And that night, I became very ill. And there was a mother and a daughter by the name of Farkas. They were from Hungary. I didn't know what happened to them after that. And Mrs. Farkas, the mother, in the morning saw that I can't stand on my feet. So she stole somewhere a blanket, I don't know where and how, and she wrapped me in this blanket and she dragged me out for Celapel. Would she have not done it, I would have been finished that morning. She dragged me out, and I went through the shower and the icy water, and then I went on this death march, about 60 kilometers, where we were again put into cattle cars. And in this cattle car, my prisoner friends surrounded me and hugged me for body warmth. And I arrived to the next camp, to Libau, totally recovered. The icy water brought my temperature down, and it was just a miracle.
But you would not recommend this for people today?
I don't think so. I don't think that that's the way to cure sore throat.
So then what happened? You arrived in Libau. Was it very far?
Libau, well, I don't even know. It wasn't very far because Libau was in Upper Silesia. But I know that the journey lasted again 3 days. I don't know what was this 3-day journey that they invented, that everything lasted 3 days.
Was it just as brutal as the first journey?
Well, I was out of it. I was sick and I had temperature and I really was worried that I'm not going to make it. When we arrived and I realized that I can walk, I can stand up, I can walk, they unloaded us at the railroad station and we walked through this little town where they never saw a Jew before. And we later were assigned to work at a crop factory.
How many were there? How many people in your crop?
In this group there was about 200 of us. And I remember that the foreman who took a liking to me afterwards told me that the population in that town was talking about the Jews being brought to the factory. And they said, oh, now we know how the Jews look, with our shaved heads, in this rag that we were wearing. They thought that that's the Jews are. And then somebody asked, and where are the horns? So it is not a myth that's what people thought of Jews.
And this was a factory that belonged to the Krupp?
To the Krupp, yeah.
The
Krupp
arms maker.
There were four factories. One was producing ammunition. One was producing boxes for the ammunition. We did Schneekette, snow chains for tanks. And
Were you working together with civilian laborers or slave laborers?
With slave Ukrainian slave laborers. And there was next door to us a French political prison, male prison, and those French boys were also working in our factories.
So you did have contact with people who were not in the camp?
Right. And the French prisoners somehow knew what was going on. I wouldn't be surprised if they had a radio or something and listening to BBC, knowing what was going on in the war. So we had some news that that the war is going bad for Hitler.
This was the end of 44, beginning of 45.
That's right. That's right.
Did they do anything nice for you for Christmas?
No, I don't remember doing anything nice for us for Christmas, but I remember in the height of the winter they caught some Dutch girls hiding in the factory, not working. And we had a Kommandoführerin who was, I don't know, 5'2". She was a very short, hideous woman who was mean and
the prisoner or
no German SS. And she tied these three women outside and she poured water on them and left them freeze outside. So nobody sabotaged after that, at least not visibly.
Well, what happened then?
Here you are,
the beginning of 45. This is after the Normandy invasion. The Allies are rolling across Europe. The Soviets are advancing into Germany. What was happening?
Well, in the last days before liberation, during the night we heard bombing and we went outdoors and we saw the Stalin candles. These were flares which the Russians dropped in midair with a parachute, and they were just hanging there in the air, lighting the whole area. And we heard the bombing. And again, we were hoping that they will bomb our factories because we did not know that that's the end, really. We just knew that the Russians are close and that they are bombing around us. And this was going on for a few nights. And then the last night, there were very heavy bombing around us. And next morning, we were not called for Zählappel to be counted. And we were afraid to walk out because we thought that maybe the Nazis are waiting for us with machine guns. We were convinced that they will not let us go, that in the last moment, they will just wipe us out. And so we stayed indoors until later in the afternoon, somebody said, well, I'm going out. I'm going to see what's going on. And we watched through the window as she walked into the middle of the Zählappel Platz. And she raised her both hands and she said, we're free. Apparently the French prisoners next door took a stovepipe and tied a white shirt on it and were marching around their prison camp screaming so we can hear it, Nazi kaput, Nazi kaput. And so we ran outdoors and we realized that the Nazis were gone. They escaped during the night. But we still didn't know what really was happening, so we were worried that they may come back, if you know how war is going back and forth. Later in the afternoon, a Cossack on a horseback, a Russian officer, rode in. He looked at us and yelled, "Вы евреи? You're Jewish?" And we didn't know whether we should say yes or no. We didn't know whether it's dangerous or not. Then finally one girl said, da, vi Yivrei. This officer jumped off the horse and came over and started to cry and hugged us and kissed us and kept yelling, Yato Je, Yivrei.
I'm also a Jew.
Yes. And then he kept saying something, this is what they did to my people. And stayed with us in the afternoon. He left for a little while, brought in a horse, which the French soldiers shot in front of us and made a goulash out of it. They emptied the kitchen pantry and got us potatoes. And that was the first meal with meat and potatoes that we had. And then he posted a guard in front of our camp and he told us not to leave. He said that the soldiers are looting and raping and we should not leave the camp. That he's going to consider this off limits and he will be back when they pass through Liba. Came back a few days later and he told us that we can now leave. And there we were on our own, realizing that now we have to re-enter that world that didn't want us.
And there was no effort made by the Soviets to give help to some kind of
organization,
food,
nothing.
Dwellings,
nothing. And it was very dangerous. I went up to the commander Tura, to this officer later, and asked him to give us a few bicycles, that maybe we can start out on a bicycle at least. We found out that we are very close to the Czechoslovakian border. And I thought, once we are back in Czechoslovakia, I speak the language and the people, I knew the Czech people, and that it's gonna start changing for us. So he gave us three bicycles with the bumashkas, with the papers, to tell us that the bicycle is ours. And as we rode out for about 6 kilometers, a group of Russian soldiers stopped us, and I very cockily took the bumashka and showed them. And they smiled at us, and they said, "Хорошо, okay," and took the bicycles. And we were on our foot walking.
And they didn't try to rape you?
No, they didn't. Apparently they must have, the way we looked, still with the shaved heads in this rag, I don't think we were too desirable.
Because you know, of course, that the Russians went through Germany raping everybody.
Absolutely. Later on, it was very dangerous for a young woman to be alone, or even a few women. Walking any place or being with around Russians. And again, I was very lucky because I had some very close calls.
So there you were on your way to Czechoslovakia.
Yes, we arrived, we crossed the border and we arrived to a small town. I don't even remember the name of the town. And I walked into a restaurant and the restaurateur looked at us and asked me in Czech, where do we come from?
How many were there? Okay, you crossed into Czechoslovakia after having your bicycles taken away by the Russian soldiers, and there you are in a restaurant in Czechoslovakia. How many of you were in your group?
There were three of us.
Uh-huh.
The ones that started out on the bicycles. And I walked over to the restaurateur and I told him that I'm from Czechoslovakia and that we are just coming out of the concentration camp. Not that he didn't know with our shaved heads and the way we were dressed. Of course, he knew.
Were you still wearing the dresses with the yellow streak in the back?
Well, that yellow streak stayed on forever. That's why I got rid of that dress. I wish today I didn't.
Could have started the new trend in fashion design.
Right. Anyway, this man was very kind. He asked me, where are we going to sleep? And I said to him that we still don't know. And he said, well, I should come back around 5 o'clock. He closes the restaurant at 5 o'clock. First he fed us, by the way. And then he told us to come back at 5 o'clock and that he will let us sleep in the booths of the restaurant. He will lock us in, which we did. And that was our first night in real freedom. And then following day, he gave us breakfast. And we were on our way. And we kept marching. And later on, of course, we found out that there is hardly any civilian transportation, that everything was occupied by the military. And so we were living dangerously. We asked Russian soldiers to pick us up on their trucks and take us wherever they went. We didn't care. We didn't know where we were going. We were just hoping that maybe we'll run into some prisoners who are coming out of the camp. And that was really what we were doing, wandering around Europe.
So what happened then? How far did you go? Where did you end up?
We wound up the first time in Brno, Brno, and we found out that the Red Cross has a place where we can sleep if we want to, and they feed us. Until then, we were sleeping in parks or in barns, whatever we found on the road. We begged for food. People recognized who we were and were fairly kind to us. Some were more human than others. And in Brno, the Red Cross also gave us a few crowns, so we had a little bit of pocket money. From there we went to Slovakia, to Bratislava. There also the Red Cross took care of us for a few days. And then somebody told us that they heard that in Budapest there is a school where people register, those who come back from the war. And so we decided to go to Budapest. It didn't matter where we going. Something very interesting happened, and this also relates to how the Russians behaved in Europe. We begged ourselves on a train, and the conductor was very kind to us and permitted us to sit on top of the coal. So we were watching what was going on the train. The trains were packed with Russian soldiers. But some of the girls coming out of the American front, the American DP camps, or from the American zone, they had big bags of stuff that the Americans gave them. They were all dressed in American uniforms, they had boots on, and they had these big bags with cigarettes and chocolate and stuff. And they sat there eating in front of us, and we had nothing. We had absolutely nothing. Never offered us anything. And that night, we were sitting on top of the coal, of course, not sleeping, very excited about, are we going to find anybody in Budapest or not? And in the middle of the night, we noticed that these big sacks on which these girls were sitting are getting lower and lower and lower. Towards the morning, we saw that they were sitting really on the floor. We also noticed that some Russian soldiers were on the outside of the train walking through the train. We didn't know what they were doing. But in the morning, we found out that they were looting these sacks that these girls had. They cut a window open on the sack and removed everything there was in it. These girls next morning had nothing. It was sort of bittersweet. I mean, we really didn't mean to be mean, but but they were not very nice.
So. What happened in Budapest?
We arrived early in the morning, and at the railroad station there were some of the Jews who were in hiding in Budapest waiting for these trains. They organized and they were waiting every train that came into Budapest.
Was the American joint active
no,
at all?
Had nothing to do with it, no, at that time. At least we didn't have anything to do with them. So
United
these
Nations.
Were individuals.
What about UNRWA? Was UNRWA?
Later in Czechoslovakia, UNRWA was very active. I don't know what happened in Hungary because we weren't there too long. So I recognized one of the boys from my hometown, and he immediately recognized me and embraced, and he was happy to see somebody from his hometown coming home. And he took us into the school, and the walls of the school were covered with paper, and alphabetically everybody signed in. So I went through the names, hoping to find somebody from the family, at least a relative, an uncle, an aunt, a cousin. Nothing. Found absolutely nothing. Was getting late. Was late in the afternoon. I started to cry, and he kept reassuring me, "Tomorrow we'll come back. Don't worry, you'll find somebody." And as I walked out the door, I pushed the door open, and the door didn't give. Somebody was behind that door. And so I stepped back to let the person come in, and my brother was standing there. I found out that he escaped from the labor camp and became a partisan, a freedom fighter.
In Czechoslovakia?
In Slovakia, in the Tatry Mountains. He was with a ski troop, and there were some Jews hiding in those mountains, so they were supplying them. And we started to talk. Probably the most interesting story that I found actually appalling was that he told me that when he was with the Slovakian partisans, that the Slovak partisans were so anti-Semitic that the Jewish boys were afraid to reveal that they were Jewish. So when I asked my brother how many Jews were in your unit, he said, "We don't know." It was an unspoken word. We knew of each other, those who were Jewish, but it was never revealed. Because he said that we would have been shot in the back. So that was pretty upsetting after all that, that even those who hated the Germans hated us even more. And then we went to a town called Košice, where my brother's girlfriend was. And the two of them stayed in Košice while I went back to Užhorod, to my hometown.
Was your brother's girlfriend one he had acquired during the war, or was that from before? And where was she during the war?
She was hiding in Budapest with the Gentile papers. And of course, until my brother was in labor camp, they had contact, but after that, they didn't. She also became very ill during hiding time. And as a matter of fact, if I recall, the first time when I went back home, she came with me. And I remember the Russian commando was in our home, and I walked in and I told him that I'm the Khazaika and that I owned the home, and they said, "Oh, that's all right. Pick a room." They would let me stay in a room if I want to stay. And then I realized that that's not the way I want to live, and I'm not going to be there. And also our housekeeper, our old housekeeper, lived upstairs in a little apartment, and she pretended that she was delighted that we came back. Of course, I'm sure she was worried that I'm going to ask back for the things that she probably took from our home. which I had no intentions doing. I didn't want anything from there. And she asked me, what should she make for us to eat? And I said to her, take 2 dozen eggs and make dumplings out of them. And then take 2 more dozen eggs and beat it like scrambled eggs over it. And my sister-in-law, and now she's my sister-in-law, my brother's girlfriend, the two of us sat down and ate the dumplings with the scrambled eggs, which was a big pot. And then we went back. And
you only took a few mementos from the house?
I took a little package where I found, as I said before, my father's gold watch and my brother's bar mitzvah watch and my gold bracelet that my father bought me for my 18th birthday. Then we went back and we found out accidentally that somebody saw my father in Theresienstadt in a hospital. So we decided to go back to Prague and go to Terezin. We found out that there may be a chance that it's him. And so my brother was looking for a truck, that if we find him, we should be able to bring him from Terezin to Prague, to a hospital. And again, accidentally, we ran into my husband, Bernard, who was in the forced labor camp with my brother earlier. And they embraced and were very pleased to see each other. And my husband, he had access to an UNRWA truck. And they went to Theresienstadt and went into a room where my father's name was on the door. And my brother went from bed to bed searching for my father and couldn't find him. And then he came back again, looked at the list, and sure enough, my father's name was there, so he went back again, and again he couldn't find him. And as he was walking out, somebody called his name. And he turned back and he said he faced this skeleton of a man. Who was dying of tuberculosis. They brought them to Prague. We took them to a very famous tubercular sanatorium called Krč. And a few months later, my father died. Before he died, he told us a very interesting story. He asked my brother whether on a certain date, whether he escaped from the labor camp. I mean, my brother told him that he escaped. And my father said, was it on such and such day? And my brother said, yeah, how do you know? My father said that he marked that date for himself because that night he dreamt that he was in the woods and this black horse was running. My brother's hair was very dark and beautiful black eyes. And he says, I grabbed this horse and the horse wiggled himself out of my way and ran. And when I woke up next morning, he said, I knew that my son is. Sorry. After my father passed away, we both decided that we don't want to stay in Europe. And in the meantime, Bernard, my husband, kept coming, visiting after that. And when my father died, he told me that he promised my father that he's going to take care of me, so he has to marry me. So we got married. And a year later, my sister-in-law had her first child. And then the following year, I had a child. And then we decided that we're going to leave Prague. Bernard, my husband, had papers to come to the United States because he lived in Prague in 1939 as a student, and he had a student visa to come to the United States to a sister. And he was caught in Holland by the Nazis, by the Gestapo, and was brought back and went through the whole concentration camp experience. And so the American government acknowledged his papers, and so we were put on the quota. But my brother couldn't. So my brother went to France, and in France, the Haganah got hold of him, and they went to Palestine, which is now the state of Israel. And even though we were lucky to find each other, we were again separated for 15 years.
15 years?
Yeah.
And
after that, when I finally was able to obtain papers, affidavits for them, then they came out here, and now, luckily, fortunately, we are together.
Where did you go in the States? In America, where did you go?
I arrived to Allentown, Pennsylvania. It's very interesting. I want you to know that I'm going next week to Prague, to my father's gravesite, where I'm going to meet my brother, who is going to be coming back from Israel, where he's visiting now. And I'm going to go from Prague to Israel. So we will meet in the middle. And this is the first time that we're going to be back together and visit my father's gravesite, on which, by the way, before we left, we engraved my mother's and my sister's name, since they didn't have a grave. And I came to Allentown, Pennsylvania on the 31st of October, 1948. And it will be on 31st of October that I'm going to be returning this time from Israel. And it was not planned. I just, when I saw it on paper, I realized. And I remember my brother-in-law waited for us at the airport. And I came with my daughter, who was then 11 months old. My husband stayed back. He got his visa a little bit later, and he wanted to go to England, where he was a young brother in an orphanage. He was taken by the UNRWA, by the way, to an orphanage in England after the war. And the plane landed in New York, in the LaGuardia. We arrived at the LaGuardia airport, and everybody was getting off the plane, and the captain came over to me and he said, you can't get off, you have to wait. And I said to myself, they are going to keep me here? What's the problem? I thought maybe something with the child, or they are going to send me back. I was terribly frightened. When everybody was off the plane, then he said, well, we can go now. He took the child from me and walked me to the door of the stairs, of the steps of the plane, handed me the child, and he said, now you can walk down. And downstairs, some cameras were taking my picture, and that's the picture I have on the mantle. I will show you later. when I arrived, my brother-in-law apparently arranged it. Some newspapers were there. I was one of the first refugees coming to Pennsylvania, to Allentown. And there was a big article about us. The interesting thing was that finally my brother-in-law was waiting for me at the airport and drove us to Allentown. And when I arrived to his home, he had two children. One was 10 years old, one was 8 years old, Michael and Susan. And they were dressed in costumes. And I said to my brother-in-law, why are these children dressed in costumes? It is not Purim. And he said, no, it's Halloween. And I said, what is Halloween? So this time when I come back, I know what Halloween is.
Did you speak English when you arrived?
I spoke a little bit English. And my sister-in-law had a room arranged for us, with a crib for the baby. She was, by the way, my sister-in-law, my husband's half-sister, who arranged for us to come to this country, was not just a sister-in-law or a sister. She, if I had my mother there waiting for me, she couldn't have been better, kinder to me, my sister Fanny. And we still are very, very close, and her children are very close to us. And I remember my sister-in-law wanted me to take a bath and just go to bed, and the baby should be in bed. And the two little children peeked through the door, and I waved to them to come in, and they didn't. And then I said, come on in. And when they heard me say in English, come on in, they jumped on my bed, and they said, you speak English? And I said, little. And then they asked me, who did you vote for? I said, what is vote? It was, I think, a day after or before that President Truman was voted into office. So I remember these little incidents very fondly.
And how was life after that?
Well, Bernard arrived Christmas night with the Queen Mary. We went to New York to wait for him.
Why didn't you come together?
We couldn't. We couldn't come together because it wasn't so simple. You know, Czechoslovakia by then was already under communist regime. And it was just not possible for both of us to come at the same time. And on top of which, he wanted to go to England to visit this younger brother before he leaves Europe. We didn't know when he's going to be able to go back and see him or whether he's going to be able to come here. And we waited for the Queen Mary, and everybody was brought down by stretchers. It was a terrible winter and stormy sea, I understand, all over here. And my husband walked down 8 pounds heavier than I left him. He says on the boat he was the only one who ate, and he gained a lot of weight. And a few weeks later, I was in touch with my aunt here in California. I had my father's sister here who came long before the war. And I was in touch with her, and she insisted that we come to Los Angeles. And so, the joint helped us to come out here by train. And I arrived on April 15, 1949. It was 115 degrees. It was a very hot day. And I looked at the palm trees, and I said to my husband, I will never leave this town again. And I love Los Angeles.
And you were in business here?
Yes. I opened my own business very early. I didn't want to work for anybody.
Did your husband work with you in this business?
No, my husband was a school teacher in Europe. But he learned a trade here, And we were in business for 37 years. I had my own factory. I was, I became a well-known name in the industry. And I lived a very glamorous life as a fashion designer. Until one day I had a phone call from the Simon Wiesenthal Center asking me, would I come to tell my story? And I laughed at Rabbi Cooper and I said, come on, after all these years, why should I now start talking about those terrible days, those terrible weeks and years? And he proceeded to tell me that that night a Jewish cemetery was desecrated in the valley, and a temple was spray-painted with swastikas. And when I heard the word swastika, I went crazy, and I hung up on him. I said, I have to think about it. And that night, I was back in camp all night in my nightmare. Next morning I woke up and I called him back and I said, I'm ready to talk. I want you to understand that when we came here and I started my business and I realized that I have to really concentrate on a family, that we were a very unique little group of people from the age of 15 to the age of 40 maybe, that we had no children and no elders, that we have to recreate a new nation. So that's what we concentrated on, and that's what I did. And I didn't talk about the Holocaust, not even to my own child, until she came later and asked me. And then, of course, she got very much involved in the subject, and when she was I think 19 years old or so, she organized the first second generation group in Los Angeles.
And this is your only daughter, Clara?
This is my only daughter. She has a daughter, Johanna.
What's her
who's
Johanna?
Named after my mother. Mm-hmm. And she's now in Israel at Bar Ilan University.
Wonderful.
Becoming religious, which I never dreamt will happen, but we are delighted about it. And myself got involved at the time with the Simon Wiesenthal Center, and I became a public speaker for the Simon Wiesenthal Center. Soon after that, I had a conflict with the fashion industry and me talking about the Holocaust. And I quit my business. And
when you say with the fashion, you mentioned that you were successful in the fashion industry when you became active in the Simon Wiesenthal Center and became a public speaker on the Holocaust. And then you said that you broke away from the fashion industry and quit your business because they were not happy about your speaking on the Holocaust? I wonder
no,
if you could explain that.
I had a conflict with it. I had a conflict with it. I had to be all the time on in the fashion industry, and I did fashion shows. And it just, I don't know, it just became trivia. And I had a hard time putting myself into one from one mood to the other. And so I sold my business. For a while I was teaching a fashion class at UCLA, and then when Rabbi Cooper asked me to come to the Simon Wiesenthal Center, he and I were the outreach program. And I realized that it's quite important that we should tell our children about the Holocaust. It was then when we first began to hear about revisionists, and then later neo-Nazis and Aryan nations and all these anti-Holocaust groups. These groups that deny, not only say that you know, the Jews are lying, but that the Holocaust, of course, never happened. And I realized that maybe that's more important at this time of my life than being glamorous.
Well, I know that you have touched and changed literally thousands, maybe tens of thousands of lives. You are going to so many schools every school year. And this, of course, this interview is being done for the archives for the future generations. Is there any message, anything you would like to say to those who might be watching these tapes 20, 30, 50 years from now?
When I speak to children, first of all, I tell them that I learned one very important lesson from the Holocaust, and that was that I would never judge people collectively. That I learned that each individual human being has to be judged by his own merit, who he is, what he does, how he acts. I also tell children that they have the power to change the world, that we each and every one of us, by our actions and how we live our lives, are changing the world for better or for the worse. And I hope that my children will follow up, will not forget where they come from. I want to leave this legacy to them. I want them to learn from our past. And I hope that it will never happen again. We are leaving behind a 20th century, which was probably the most violent, most brutal centuries in the history of mankind. And I pray and hope that the 21st century will be better, not for my sake. I certainly will not be here anymore, but for my children's, grandchildren's sake, and for humanity in general. I hope that the world will come to their senses, and that there won't be another Bosnia or another Africa, or any of the genocides that occurred in my lifetime.
Your story is certainly a testament to the brutality that human beings are capable of. And you mentioned some of the individual cases where friends or supposed friends betrayed you or didn't help you, and the help you didn't get in so many instances. Yet at the same time, you mentioned that your sister-in-law was hidden by Gentiles and saved that way in Budapest.
She was not hidden by Gentiles.
Oh.
She was hiding with Gentile papers. She was in hiding on her own. She went through terrible times. Both, I have another sister-in-law who also was hiding in Budapest. And they were terrified every moment when they are going to be captured, because there were stopping people on the street with identifications, and if they didn't believe that your papers were authentic, you were finished in Budapest. And men had it even worse, because if they felt that a man is not that his papers are fake, they just made them take off their pants, the Jewish men who were circumcised, and they immediately took them.
In Europe, most men are not circumcised if they're Christians, correct?
That's right. They weren't. I don't know today, but at that time they weren't.
Well, I sometimes tell the groups that I speak before that I have never met a single survivor who doesn't know at least one, maybe several people who were saved by Gentiles. Would that hold true for you?
Well, I happen to be fortunate enough to meet here in Los Angeles a man by the name of John Widener. I don't know whether you knew him. He was a Dutchman who organized an escape route from Holland through France into Spain and into Switzerland. He and his sister, as a matter of fact. And his sister was captured by the the Gestapo and died in a concentration camp. And John escaped. And then he was captured again and escaped. And he tells a very interesting story. And I tell it to the children. He said that his father was a Dutch minister who he used to listen to on Sundays. And that his father used to end his sermon by saying, if you save a life, it is as if you saved a whole nation. And he says, I didn't know what my father meant. And then he told a little story, which says that a little boy was praying to God to please look at this world and save the people because they are killing each other, they are hating each other. And the little boy said, please God, send someone to help us. And God answered, I did, I send you. He says, when I first heard what was happening to the Jewish people, he says, I immediately understood what I had to do. And he says, then it was no doubt in my mind that I must help. And it was that simple. I also met a woman by the name of Irene Updike from Poland, who hid, I think, 13 Jews in the Nazi headquarters where she was a maid. I mean, there are amazing stories. The unfortunate thing is that there were very few of those. The Schindlers, the Raoul Wallenbergs, unfortunately very few. And I often wonder, and I heard Rabbi Heyer one day saying this, and I thought about it, that when they called the Wannsee Conference to arrange for this final solution, if there would have been some Schindlers or some Raoul Wallenbergs among those Nazis, how would have been the Holocaust recorded? What would have been the difference?
I think you have some pictures that
yes,
people could look at.
Yes, I certainly
I
do.
I think that this is the right time to do so.
Good.
So why don't we do that? Renee, you mentioned Bernard, your husband, quite a few times, and I wonder if you'd like to actually introduce him to us.
Well, this is the young man I married. His name is Bernard Firestone, as you know, and we've been married, I think, 48 or 49 years, fighting, loving. We took the whole gamut, did the whole gamut.
Would you like to add anything to that, Bernard?
Yes, mainly fighting.
Well, I'm glad to see that all that happened has not deprived you of a sense of humor.
So
glad to see that you still laugh a lot, you're a happy person, you're enjoying life, and most importantly, you have made life so much better for so many thousands of people.
Thank you.
Thank you, Renee.
That's the advice I give usually young couples. If they fight long enough, they will stay married long enough.
Right.
Thank you, Si.
Anything other than fighting that you might add to what makes a marriage last as long as yours did?
Well, we've been working together for many years.
No, you want me
quite
to
devoted
that.
To each other.
And of course, you share two dogs.
We've just lived a normal family life. We work together. We're in the same business. And we do the same thing all the time.
And also, we have spoken quite a great deal about the family you have lost, the people you have known. And some of the pictures.
And the family we have now.
And the family.
Our child, our daughter, and our granddaughter.
Absolutely. And I think that it would be very nice if you could show us some of the people in
pictures.
Some of the people that you have.
And I just want you to know that my granddaughter adores her grandpa.
Well, is that so unusual?
Well, I don't know. It's not unusual.
Well, I can tell you it isn't. My granddaughter adores her grandpa.
I hope so.
So there you are.
Well, thank you
now
very
let
much.
Us see some of those pictures.
Absolutely. And this picture is, on this picture is my father, Maurice Weinfeld. The picture was taken, I think, in 1918 or 1919. He was in the Austro-Hungarian army. And I am not sure, but I think it was taken in Ungvar, which was Ushhorod during Czechoslovakia. And this picture was taken in Ushhorod, Czechoslovakia, I think around 1932. On the picture is my mother in the middle, Johanna Weinfeld, maiden name Rosenfeld. On the right side is my father, Maurice Weinfeld. And I am on the left side, Renee Firestone now. This picture is really a treasure for me. I recovered it just recently. It's a picture of me at the age of maybe 12. I used to dance on all kinds of social dinners and charity events. So it's hard for me to believe that that's me. It was done in Ushhorod, Czechoslovakia, just before the Hungarians took over the region. Probably around the same year, 32, 34. Maybe. This picture was taken about the same time, 1932, 34, between that time, of my little sister Clara Weinfeld in Ushhorod, Czechoslovakia, probably performing the same time I was performing. This is again my little sister Clara. This picture was taken at the river Uzh of my hometown, Ushhorod, which was named after that river. And this picture was taken shortly before they took us away from home. She was 14 years old, and she died in Auschwitz, 1938 probably. By the way, I made a mistake on the previous picture of my sister. It was taken probably 1944, just before they took us to camp. This is my brother, Frank Valenta now, changed his name from Weinfeld. And this picture, I think, was taken in Israel. He went to Israel when I came to the United States. I have no idea where or what year. He still looks very young then. This is me. The picture was taken right after the war, probably in Prague, Czechoslovakia. This is new hair after my shaved head. This was the first hair that grew out. And I don't know why, but when I look at this picture, my eyes are crying. Maybe it's just my fantasy. It was taken in 1945. I was here 2021. I'm not sure. This is my husband and I. The picture was taken in Prague. It really is not our wedding picture, but since we don't have a wedding picture, this is what we're using as a substitute. It was, the picture was taken in 1947. This picture was taken while I was coming down from the plane with my daughter, Clara, who was 11 months old at the time. The picture was taken in 1948. October 31st under LaGuardia Airport. We arrived to New York and then went to Pennsylvania. This is my daughter Clara. She was named after my little sister who died in Auschwitz. The picture was taken in Los Angeles. I'm not sure, but I am in the late 70s or early 80s. I'm not sure. This is my granddaughter, Johanna Spector. The picture was taken, I think, 2 years ago in 1992 in Los Angeles. This is a family picture that somebody sent me from South America. Where it survived, how it survived, I don't know. The picture was taken in 1932. On the left side, that little girl is me. Next to me is my mother, and then my father. And next to it is my father's sister, Berta Jakubovic was her name, and my uncle, Joseph Jakubovic. And the bride is their daughter. Her name was Julia, and she was my first cousin. And the groom was also my first cousin, and his name was Dr. Fred Weinfeld. Next to him is his mother. I don't remember her name because she was remarried, and I don't remember her name. And next to her is her second husband. The two people on the end, I don't know. They were some second aunts and uncles. I'm not going to describe all the people, but they were all related, either cousins or aunts and uncles. In the front row, the children are, his name was Tibi Jakubovic. He was the bride's brother. By the way, you did an interview with his brother, Ferry, who's on the other, Frank, who's on the other end. Did you do that interview? The two girls on the two sides, I don't know, and in the middle is my little sister, Clara. Those were cousins and relatives. The picture, by the way, the wedding was in Ushorod in Czechoslovakia.
This is on-site interview with Renee Firestone. We're in Auschwitz, January 26, 1995.
My name is Renee Firestone. When I was brought here 50 years ago, my name was Renee Weinfeld. I was brought on these tracks on a train full of cattle cars with my parents and with my 14-year-old sister. I am listening to the wind blowing here and the quiet terrain. I can still hear the sounds of the masses of people that were pouring out of the cattle cars. I can still hear the cries of children looking for their parents and parents looking for their children. It is still in my ears. I hear this mother yelling, Hanele, Hanele, where are you? And then I turned back to the cattle car and I called for my little sister. And I took her off the cattle car. And in seconds, I looked around and my parents were gone. And there we were, the two of us separated, our world collapsed. Our life has changed forever. Dr. Mengele stood in the middle of the road here and pointed people to go to the right and people to the left. I remember my sister and I were going to the right. And as we were coming into the camp through this gate, at one point my sister noticed that my mother is on the other side, and she kept yelling, Mom, Mom, and she wanted to run to her, and I wouldn't let her. And
then she just disappeared, and we were marched into the camp. Maybe you want to follow me in now? It is hard to comprehend the thousands of people that were pouring out of these cattle cars. I can't even describe the scene. It is impossible to describe the scene. On the loudspeakers, the Nazis were telling us to leave our belongings behind. They will deliver it into the camp. Of course, we had no idea what the camp meant. We didn't know who Mengele was, who was pointing us one direction and the other. And we left the little belongings that we still kept from home. We left it on the railroad station right here. And then my sister and I was walking through this gate. We had no inkling what is awaiting us. We had no idea what this place was, where this place was. We didn't know even what country we are in. We went all the way to the end. We walked through all the way to the end. There is a bathhouse there. That's where we got undressed. They told us to leave all our belongings again in the dressing room, so this is the last piece of clothing off our bodies. We walked into a room which was the shower room. We never came back into the dressing room. Naked, in windy, cold weather like this, we walked out naked on the other side of the bathhouse, and we stood there from about mid-afternoon till approximately midnight. It is indescribable, the pain, the fear, the hunger. And you know, today I'm here exactly 50 years. We're going to commemorate today the liberation of this camp. I just can't believe, I cannot believe that I'm still alive, that I lived it through, that it was possible to live something so diabolical through. I hope that the world will see what was going on here, and will comprehend what it really means to humanity to remember what is going on, what was going on here. My mother, by the time my sister and I came out of the shower, out of the bathhouse, and went into another barrack where they shaved our heads and gave us a piece of rag to wear. By the time we went back into the camp, my mother was reduced to ashes. My father disappeared. My whole world, my whole life was ending. From the bathhouse, they brought us back to this camp here. This was Sea Lager. This was the Hungarian women's lager. If you want to follow me, I'll take you to the barracks where I was in. This is Lager B2C. This was the Hungarian women's camp. I stayed in this barrack. It was barrack 28. You must understand that all these wires were charged with high voltage electricity. That if you just went near these wires, you were killed. Death was around every corner. No matter how you tried to save yourself, it was impossible. Only God could save you here. I remember when I was in this camp, I was still with my little sister. We were somewhere in the middle of the block, in a bunk where there were 12 of us. squeezed in. We could hardly fit in. In our sleeps, we always had nightmares, but when we woke up, the nightmare, the reality was worse than the nightmare. Now that I look around and I see how huge this camp is, I just can't comprehend it, because when I was here, millions of people were here. This wasn't a waste, empty space like this. There was no grass, mud, or snow, or dry ground, dry frozen ground. We were always sitting in the mud. This wind that you feel here, well, to save ourselves from this wind, wearing this one piece of clothing that we had on, we had to sit around the edges of the barracks, you know, sitting on the edge of the barracks, protecting ourselves with the walls of the barracks, because we were always outdoors. We could come into the barracks only to sleep. There was a small cubicle like this, probably this was it, which was the capo's room. She slept here. She had a cot in it, and in the middle here, where the chimney is, there was a brick chimney-like walking through the whole barrack, which of course never had any heat in it. Then 6 months later, I was separated from my sister, and I was taken into the next camp, which used to be the Czech Lager, which was murdered overnight, the whole lager. There were parents with children living there, and the whole camp was eliminated one day. I see these pigeons here. Well, let me tell you, there were no pigeons here. Nothing lived here. There were no birds. Not even a rat could survive here. This is a place of this was Lucifer's inferno. The chimneys of the crematoria were visible from here on all sides. They were bellowing fire and soot 24 hours a day, and we knew that it was our brothers and sisters that were being burned. The trains were coming in 24 hours a day, 3-4 trains a day, and the prisoners were walking through this gate to go to the bathhouse. And as they were passing by, we used to beg them, throw your bread. You won't be able to keep it anyway. Just why don't you throw it to us? We are hungry. And they didn't know what we were talking about. They thought we were crazy. Why should they throw their food away for us or to us? You know, tomorrow, we will commemorate the day when this ceased to be the place of suffering and murder and unspeakable horror to thousands and thousands of my fellow Jews. I can't believe it. I just can't believe it. If these wires, if these bricks could talk, the stories they could tell, the suffering and the starvation and the beatings and the punishments. If there is such a thing as a soul, I hope that my mother and my sister can hear me now. It is their martyrdom that helped me till now to try to help the world, to try to tell the world what happened here. And I want them to hear me say that I will never forget them. And probably soon we will be together again. I'm sorry. Maybe we should move on. I don't remember, did I tell you that these wires were charged with high voltage electricity? You couldn't come this close to it because it just immediately you were just drawn to the electricity, you were finished. People came to these wires when they could not bear anymore the suffering and the hunger and the starvation. Every morning you could see people hanging from these wires, committing suicide, ending their lives. I'm looking at this today, and it's hard to believe. It's hard to believe if these poles could tell the stories, the things that happened here. It couldn't be true. We keep saying to ourselves, it couldn't be true. Yet we all are marked. We all have the numbers on our arms, which tells us that yes, we were here, and now I can touch these wires and nothing happens. Well, I learned something here, but I wonder whether the world learned anything. The way you look around the world today, you wonder, what did we learn from the Holocaust? What did we learn from this place? Why don't people learn to live in peace with each other? Why don't they learn to respect one another? It's unbelievable. Unbelievable that we still can't get along. We still can't live with each other. Look at this place. Look at the size of it. Can you imagine the millions that perished here? It's hard for me to remember. It's hard for me to comprehend what I experienced here. I only hope that will never happen to any people anywhere in the world. That's all I hope for, and that's all I pray for. Before the train arrived here, a little further back, the train stopped, and everybody was curious where we are. Nobody knew what country, what town. So one of the boys picked me up on his shoulders and asked me to look out and tell them if I can see anything. And I remember I saw that we are on a railroad station. And there was a train standing there, another train full of people like us. And then all of a sudden I saw the sign, and the sign said Krakow. And without me even thinking, before it even hit my brain what that meant, I yelled back to the cattle car, "We are in Krakow." And I remember that out of that silence, all of a sudden, like a beehive, everybody started to talk. Everybody panicked. We all of a sudden realized that we are somewhere in Poland. And we knew that Poland is the bad place to be in, because we already heard rumors that in Poland the Nazis were killing the Jews. I remember the train starting to move again, and the silence returned. And then the silence was again broken with this screeching whistle of the train. And from Krakow all the way here, the whistle never stopped. Of course, later we found out that was the signal for the Nazis to prepare the selection place, because a transport is coming. These transports were coming in all the time. And that whistle of the train is still in my ears. That's why when I look around again and I see how quiet this place is and how serene it looks, it certainly didn't look like this then. I think this is crematoria number 5. I think that my mother was killed here, and most probably my little sister also. It is pretty hard to visualize what this place looked like before. Somewhere under here, there was a gas chamber. And maybe it's here where the elevator brought up the bodies, and then they were disposed of in the ovens. I don't know what I can say about it. I don't know how I can even speak about it. It is so frightening. It's just something beyond the human understanding. People come here, I see, and they light candles. I've seen a few candles around here. And somebody left a wreath with Jewish colored ribbons. Probably someone whose parents also perished here. How can anybody believe this, that this happened? But we must show it, and we must remember it, and we must show it to the world. I'm gonna come back here also, and I'm gonna light the candle. You know, I can't even imagine what this place was like. I recently read Dr. Neasley's book, and he writes about this place, and it's just unbelievable how many people were murdered here. Look at this. Probably here it was. Of course, the Nazis blew it up before they left, because they didn't want the world to know what this place was all about. Some of this stuff. Can you imagine if this could speak, if this could tell the stories? if the souls could speak here. I can't describe it. I can't describe what I feel either. I don't know whether I don't feel fear more than anything else. Fear for future generations. I pray to God that nothing like this will ever be built again. Look at the size of this. Unspeakable. Here I can do only one thing, pray for my mother's soul, for my sister's soul, and hope that they are resting in peace, because I am not. If you follow me, we're gonna go to the pits now. I will show you something else that you won't believe.
And this is the bathhouse. This is the bathhouse. In these big ovens, they were disinfecting the clothes. Not our clothes, because we never changed clothes here. But when they killed the people, then they stripped them, and of course, they disinfected their clothes. Or if prisoners from the camp were killed or had to go away, this is where they brought to disinfect the clothes. By the way, I want you to know that this place was filled with lice. Our clothes was always filled with lice, and we had no way of cleaning it. So you can imagine that the Nazis were terribly scared of typhus, which was rampant here. And that's why this is where they brought all our belongings once we were gone. And this also is a place of horror. On the two sides, there are two shower rooms, where the prisoners were brought and took a shower, and then we were disposed of on the side of the bathhouse. There is a space, when we go out I will show you, which was a barrack at one time. And then we went in there and they shaved our heads and they sprayed us with DDT, and then finally they gave us a piece of rag which was disinfected here. And that's how we entered the camp itself. We no longer looked like human beings. We no longer felt like human beings. It's, how can I describe that? How can I show you what it looked like? Thousands of women, with the shaved heads, we looked like comic strips. I remember I couldn't find my sister. Once we got out of here, I couldn't find my sister, couldn't recognize her. Took me a few hours before I recognized her. I wonder what are these scratches on the wall.
Who knows? Who knows what's here? I remember that we went into an underground dressing room from the outside, and somehow I don't remember where we were coming up to the shower room. I see something here that goes deep, but that's just an oven. Let's see what's happening here. Yeah, it's hard for me to recreate, you know, in my mind how it exactly worked. But somewhere outside, there should be an underground passage into a dressing room. And from that dressing room, once we left all our belongings, they told us to be very neat and to fold our belongings very neatly and leave it in a pile so that when we come back, we can remember exactly where our clothing is. Needless to say, we walked into the shower room and everything was taken away, and we walked out totally stark naked. It's just hard to remember. It's hard to believe that it happened. Also, somewhere here, I don't know, maybe it was in this corridor, I don't remember, Dr. Mengele walked in and took me out of the line. And he was with another man, another doctor, and they took me under a light somewhere in one of those rooms, I don't remember which one, and questioned me and asked me why I'm here. Well, first of all, I didn't know who Mengele was. Second of all, I had no idea where I am and why I'm here. So I said, I'm a Jew, that's why I'm here. And, you know, it's very hard for me to recreate exactly what this place was. This must have been the oven where they were heating those barrels, where the steam was coming from, I don't know. But every nook here, every corner is so scary. There is death around here, everywhere. That's all you feel. You just feel death present. And you keep asking yourself, how many died here? How many prisoners worked at this oven? How many of them were destroyed afterwards? I just can't describe how I feel. I can't describe how I'm trying to understand, make some sense of this. But it just doesn't make any sense. No matter how hard you try, it just doesn't make any sense. These are these barrels where the clothing was disinfected. I told you, the clothes that came off, dead bodies especially, or if you changed from one camp to another, you came into the bathhouse again, they reshaped your head, disinfected you and your clothing. I remember just before we left Auschwitz, we stood out there naked, waiting for our clothes to be finished, so we can get on our death march. But just, as I said before, just every corner here, you can sense death, you can sense destruction, evil, just an evil place.
There.
This is where some of the people were unloaded when the crematorias were overloaded and people had to wait to be gassed. They came through that road and they were spread around here women, old women, children were sitting around waiting to decide what's going to happen to them. And many times when the crematorias were, as I said, overloaded, and it, during the final solution it was almost all the time, then they dug these pits. There is one over there also, I see, and I think that's the children's pit, I'm not sure. And they were burning people in these pits. These pits were prepared in such a way that it drained the fat from the people that were burning, and it collected the fat in a place. And then they doused the new people with that fat so that the pit should be burning well through the whole time. You know, when I see these things now and I try to remember these things, only then can I understand how devilish this whole place was, how premeditated, pre-planned, every corner, every step that the prisoners made was pre-planned. They knew exactly what's going to happen to us. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. And we were so naive or stupid that we just walked right into it. Of course, what human mind could have imagined what was going on here? No normal human mind can understand that or imagine it. I still cannot believe what I have seen here. And look at it, it's so peaceful, so quiet. The other day, there were two deer war roaming around this place. There was nothing alive here, nothing. Everything was dead. Even those of us who stayed in the camps were already dead. And we knew that we are dead. We knew that there is no way we are going to survive. It is really only by a miracle that it happened, that I'm here. Only by the grace of God. You know, it's so funny. I've been talking to children in schools about my experiences for 20 years. Now that I'm standing here, the words just don't come, because there are no words for this. Whatever I say is so meaningless, so trivial. You can't really describe this. Forgive me, there's just nothing I can say about this place. I understand that some Russian soldiers, prisoners of war, are buried here, Jews and non-Jews, and that's what represents the crosses and the Stars of David. I see these guardhouses. We were watched from those towers every moment, every move we made. We couldn't speak to each other. Every human being who survived here was on his own, and every life was in danger every moment of the stay here. Nobody believed that we ever will leave this place. We just couldn't believe it, because we saw what was going on here. The chimneys were burning 24 hours a day, and the fire was bellowing out of it. You could see it, you could smell it. It permeated this whole territory. You know, people in the city say that they didn't know what was going on. It's impossible. It's impossible. The smell permeated this place in such a way that it ate itself, the smell ate itself into our flesh. For years I could smell it on myself. There's just no way they didn't know. No way. And what should we say about those who claim that it never happened? How can we convince people? Look around. How can we convince people that there was a place that resembled only hell? Well, I hope that the world will see it while it is still here, because we are not going to be here much longer. And once we, the survivors, are gone, I'm afraid the world will completely forget. I hope not, but unfortunately, that's what I feel. It is, half of it is already destroyed. How much longer that the whole place is going to be cleared? And who knows, some apartment houses will be built over this place where we left our loved ones, where there are no graves for them. There is a little river not far from here called the Vistula, and the ashes were disposed in that river. And I understand that even today, at summertime, when the river is flowing, you can see bones and teeth on the surface. How can we tell these people who say it never happened? Come here and look around, see what's going on, see what it looks like. You see, when you look around, you see nothing here. But when I look around, I see the thousands of frightened human beings sitting, waiting. Please don't ever forget. I'm asking you, you are still young, you'll be here for a while. Please don't let the world forget. That's the plaque in memory of Edith Stein. She was a nun who was brought here because she was Jewish. She had a Jewish grandparent, or maybe even a parent, I'm not sure. But some part of her was Jewish. So she was brought to Auschwitz as a Jew and killed here. And that's the plaque that probably the Carmelite nuns put up for her. I think that she became a saint. I'm not sure there was I remember a controversy about whether she should or should not be made into a saint, but I don't know what eventually happened, but that's her name, Edith Stein.